Almost every year, in late December, I'm plagued with mild gastric problems, which is probably kind of a personal thing to discuss in this type of forum, except that I thought about it long and hard and realized that these problems are a direct result of what I would call a pagan conspiracy to rob me of my good health. Allow me to explain. When we talk about pagans or heathens, we're usually talking about people who are not members of major religions. Some religions are very well known to us in the West. Others might be slightly less well known. For some, we might have only the vaguest knowledge, and still others we might not know at all. The history of religion is a very interesting topic. It seems that in the earliest stages, people worshipped nature, worshipped the earth, the sun, the moon, the tree. Here's a tree. And it would make a lot of sense that people would worship trees. They're very big, they're beautiful, they're strong, and they outlast the lifespan of most humans. For a lot of early peoples, if a tree was sacred, well, a forest would be even more sacred, because there's a lot of trees. And if there was a river running through it, even better, because some cultures worshipped water, and if there were rocks in the river, well, some cultures worshipped stones. Eventually, gods began to be associated with these things, and the gods then took on an independent life of their own. In Northern Europe, for example, you had gods like Thor and Freya and Woden, or Odin. Odin in Scandinavian literature is usually presented like this, as an old broken-down man with a hat that he pulls down over one eye to hide the fact that he lost one of them. If you look at the genealogy as it's presented in Old English documents, you see that Woden had a son named Wadi, who had a son named Segar, who begat Swadi, who was the parent of Siget, and then there was Sebald, Seafowl, Westerfalcon, Wilgus, Westfri, and If, with two Fs. And the son of If was a fellow by the name of Alla, who was the ruler, from 560 to 588, of a kingdom called Deira, up north, long before England was unified. Alla himself had a descendant named Edwin, and some people think that the city of Edinburgh was named for him. And Edinburgh has produced so many people of note over the years that it would be quite time-consuming to go through them all. Now, as the story goes, at one time some slaves from the northern part of England were being unloaded in Rome, and this unloading was witnessed by a young priest. He asked, "Who are these people?" And he was told, "Well, they are Angles," because you had the Angles and the Saxons. Now, educated priests at that time were trained to see everything as a metaphor, or a simile, or an allegory, or whatever those things are. And he thought, well, the Angles, that's like the Latin word angeli, which means angels, for they are so lovely to behold that surely they must be blessed by the angels. Well, you can decide for yourself how lovely they were. Then he asked, what is the name of the country they are from? And he was told, Deira, and he interpreted this as De Ira, which is Latin for from wrath. Ah, they must have been saved from the wrath of Satan and of heathenism. Then he asked, what is the name of their king? And he was told Alla, and he thought, ah yes, well, surely Alleluia must be sung in that country before all too long. Well, this young priest eventually rose up through the ranks to become pope and was known as Gregory the Great. And Gregory the Great did not forget his experience and made it his purpose to further save the Anglo-Saxons. And so he decided to send Augustine, who was a company man, an old friend, and a good buddy, over to England in 595 and carry out some initial Christianization. England at the time was a collection of different kingdoms, but the easiest one to get to was called Kent, and so Augustine crossed the English Channel and entered into that little kingdom to start his mission. The king of Kent at that time was a man by the name of Ethelbert. And Augustine and Ethelbert had a number of conversations about Christianity. Actually, the conversations were very slow-moving, because Ethelbert only spoke English, and Augustine only spoke Latin and Italian. So there were some barriers to break down. Ethelbert was married to a woman named Bertha, who already was a Christian, and Bertha encouraged Ethelbert to convert, which he wasn't really willing to do for a time, until she made it clear that things were not going to be very good for him until he did convert. Well, eventually he saw the light on a number of levels and became a Christian. And Augustine was happy, and Bertha was happy, and of course, God was happy. Ethelbert set up Augustine in a little office, with all the privileges and immunities befitting a holy man, and he did this in a city of the Kentish people, which was called the City of the Kentish People, or, in Old English, Kent Warra Burg, Kent meaning Kent, Burg meaning town, and Warra meaning people. Warra is the same root as we have in the word werewolf, a half-man, half-wolf. And this Kent Warra Burg became known later as Canterbury. And so Augustine was the first bishop of Canterbury, and the office later became the Archbishop of Canterbury. Well, Augustine had converted the king, and the king could say to his people, as the king, well, you people are now Christians too. But there was still some work to be done. You had to convince the people that Christianity was actually a good thing, and to practice it actively. And so Augustine used little tricks, like showing how similar the cross was to Thor's hammer, and also showing that it could be very useful to have a cross in your hand for various unforeseen emergencies. Under Augustine, Ethelbert, and their successors, Christianity was really taking off, and spread to other kingdoms on the island of Britain. It wasn't 100%, but it was pretty impressive. It was so impressive, in fact, that a later pope, when he wanted to Christianize Germany, chose an Englishman named Winfrith of Wessex to do the job. Winfrith of Wessex was very unhappy in life because his name was Winfrith and he was being beaten up on a daily basis. But when the Pope chose him for this mission, he was given the name Boniface, not to be confused with other famous people named Boniface, and suddenly his mood improved significantly. He was sent to Fulda, which is today pretty much the geographic center of Germany. Well, in Fulda, there was an oak that was sacred to the people there, and Boniface, who needed a strong statement to announce his presence, took his little hatchet and decided to chop that tree down, much to the horror of those present. Now, according to the story, the tree was old and dying and sort of hollow and rotting inside, and he used this as an opportunity to say, you see, your souls are just like this tree. You have these beliefs, but your souls are empty inside because you have not accepted Christianity. And before the people could even start arguing against it, he began to baptize them left and right into the Christian religion. Well, they were Christians now, but they didn't quite know what that meant. So they would ask questions that were, to them, extremely logical. They would ask, can we still have our stone worship? Boniface said, no, you can't. They asked, can we still have our idol worship? He said, no, you can't do that. That's no. And they asked, can we still have our tree worship? And Boniface thought a minute, and he said, you know, you can't have your tree worship, but you can keep as an ornament this, the evergreen tree. And he thought, this was a nice tree, because its color showed it was ever blooming, even in winter, showing that joy could always be in their hearts, and it was vaguely triangular, so that could remind them of the Holy Trinity. And he said, you can't worship this, but you can keep it around as a decoration. Say, around Christmas time. Make it your Christmas tree. And the Christmas tree eventually became a fixture in many a German living room. Well, this takes us up to Martin Luther, or Martin Luther, the great reformer himself. Supposedly, it was Luther's idea to light up the Christmas tree with candles. His early attempts were not as successful as his later attempts, but so be it. And so, through the Renaissance, there were Christmas trees, all decorated in nice colors, and brightly lit up. Now, in 1714, Queen Anne of England died, and descended into the eternal glory that was the realm of heaven. So they had to do a search for the nearest relative, and they found him to be Kurfürst Georg Ludwig of Hanover, who was brought to England, and he assumed the throne under the name George I. Well, Christmas rolled around over in London, and he said to his servants, where is my Christmas tree? And the servants said, well, what exactly is a Christmas tree? They wanted to keep him happy, of course. And he said, well, you know, it's like a thing with a, it's a got a, it's. So eventually they figured out what he wanted, and they went out and got him an evergreen tree, and he seemed pretty happy. Well, one of the king's descendants was a queen by the name of Victoria, who had a German background, of course, but also took as her prince consort a German by the name of Prince Albert. He was actually her first cousin, but don't judge. And Prince Albert brought with him further elements of German culture, along with, again, the Christmas tree. Now, Victoria was very popular with the English, and mass media had grown tremendously since the time of George I, and when it was revealed that Victoria had a Christmas tree in her living room, or perhaps in her royal sitting room, well, the English were delighted to put one up in theirs, or to be more correct, to put ones up in theirs. Now, the Americans, who were not going to be out-Victorianed by the Victorians, also decided to decorate their homes with Christmas trees. And of course, in the 1850s, there was considerable immigration from Germany, especially to cities like Cincinnati and Milwaukee, which not coincidentally became a big beer brewing town, and Christmas trees became pretty much ubiquitous. That's right, I said ubiquitous. And so an element of Christmas became decorating the tree and having a lot of fun doing it. And I personally get a big kick out of the happiness and joy associated with all of these things. But then when it gets close to Christmas, I remember, oh yeah, I'm Jewish, so I can't really participate in a way that's meaningful. So Christmas is pretty much a normal day for me, and I want to do stuff with my friends, but my friends are usually unavailable because they're sleeping late, because they stayed up late all night celebrating or going to church late Christmas Eve, so there's not really much left to do for me on December 25th, except maybe to stop by Happiness Gardens Korean restaurant, where I usually eat hot pepper pork, which technically speaking does not fit in well with my religious beliefs, but I sometimes eat it anyway, maybe a little too much of it, resulting in minor gastric problems. And instead of taking some responsibility for myself and just eating a little less or eating something else entirely, I prefer to take the easy way out, which is to create the idea of a conspiracy, blaming it on the past and all kinds of historical and non-historical and even mythical figures, and to say, thank you so very much, Woden.